Okay, good morning, welcome back. So, don't be so surprised. So, we will start with the second law of thermodynamics, we will try to complete it also. In the next class, we will start off with radiative transfer in the atmosphere, right? So, second law of thermodynamics is Carnot cycle, entropy, all that, you all know it very well. So, we will quickly go through this. The most important thing for us is the Clausius-Clapeyron equation. The Clausius-Clapeyron equation helps you to find out how the saturated vapor pressure changes with temperature that is related to the latent heat. Right? People who are in mechanical engineering must have studied the Clausius-Clapeyron equation in one course. Somewhere it is ringing a bell. All right. So now the second law of thermodynamics. What is the basic goal of today's lesson? Basically, is to introduce a Carnot cycle and get the efficiency as a function of T1 and T2. But there is no heat engine. We are not going to use a heat engine here. It's not mechanical engineering. From the Carnot cycle, the absolute temperature scale is devised. From that, we can and then we move on to the concept of entropy. And then we prove that the constant potential temperature is the same as isentropic lines. So, we will say that isentropic lines, constant potential temperature lines or a dry adiabat or a saturated adiabat can be used as a surrogate or as a proxy for an isentropic process, which you already know, we have discussed it so many times, reversible and adiabatic. The reversible and adiabatic process is also known as the isentropic process, that you already know, but we will have to, for the sake of completeness, we will go through those arguments. And then we will say the delta S is greater than or equal to 0 of the universe, right? The principle of increase of entropy that we will see. And towards the end of the lecture, we will derive the Clausius-Clapeyron equation from first principles using the Carnot cycle. The Clausius-Clapeyron equation tells you how much the vapor pressure will change with temperature, okay? What is it actually? Your TS diagram of the steam, okay? Liquid plus vapor and vapor. This shape, how do you get this curve? That is basically coming from the Clausius-Clapeyron equation. Okay, so that is the program. Now, Sade-Carnot devised a hypothetical cycle, which was never tested. It's an hypothetical cycle consisting of two reversible adiabats and two reversible isothermal process. A reversible process is one which is very slow. That means when you take it from A to B, it is possible for you to bring it back from B to A without any change in the system or in the surroundings. If it is an irreversible process, you can bring it back from B to A, but there will be change in the surroundings, okay? If there is no change in the system and surroundings, then it is a reversible and adiabatic process. If a balloon is filled with air and you prick it, then it is an irreversible process. It is not so easy to get the air back from the balloon. It is possible to do it, but with work. But for pricking, if you assume that the energy, the work done in pricking is zero, then there is no work done in this. But to fill the balloon back is a big job for you. So that is any sudden process, an irreversible process. So the reversible processes are also called quasi-static processes, a succession of equilibrium states, and the process proceeds very slowly. This is the cornerstone of thermodynamics. We start with a quasi-static process. Since all of you have taken ME 1100, the first semester. Is there anybody who has not taken that? Everybody has taken. So, I think all this you know. Now, the second law. Consider a cycle consisting of four processes, 1, 2, 3 and 4. 2, 3 is an isotherm, 4, 1 is an isotherm, 1, 2 is an adiabat, that means no heat transfer. Isotherm is a constant temperature process, this is an adiabat. So, there is an isothermal heat addition of Q1 into the cycle. In the process 2, 3, and there is a isothermal heat rejection of Q2. Okay, I am not going into how do you do this. Actually, there is a piston and cylinder. There is a medium here. It is insulated everywhere. Bottom is allowed to exchange heat. There are two reservoirs, T1 and T2. This is the source. Okay. So, you can make this go from one position from here to some other position. So, it is compressed. Then you make it into contact with T1. Then there will be heat addition. It will be heated up. Then because of this, it will again expand. It will do the work. It will go back to some position 3. Then it will come back and the cycle gets repeated and so on. All right. So, this is basically the cycle. Now, you know that the cycle is basically 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. So, from 1 you start and you get back to 1. So, if you start from 1 and get back to 1, what is the delta U?
0.
Very good. So, for the cycle, Q net equal to W net. What is the Q net in this process, in the cycle? So, in a 1000 megawatt power plant, okay, let us say in a 500 megawatt power plant, if 1000 megawatts is input or 1200 megawatts is input to the plant and 500 megawatts is produced, how many megawatts are rejected to the surrounding? 700 megawatts. So, if you actually improve the efficiency of a power plant, the amount of heat which is rejected will reduce and therefore, the global warming will decrease. Okay. So, apart from increasing the plant efficiency, how mechanical engineers can contribute to reduce global warming is to improve the efficiency of the power plants. Not only we will have more realization, more bang for buck, what do they say? More bang for the buck, that is for 1 kg or 1 ton of coal, you can get more power. Also, it will be environmentally less polluting. All right. Now, what is this Q net anyway? Is that okay? Now, which are the two zeros? An adiabatic process is no heat transfer. Very good. Now, consider process 2, 3. What is the CVDT of process 2, 3? What process is it? What is CVDT of that? Very good. I think you should start doing this. If you want, you write your own notes why it is 0. Okay. So, therefore, Q1. That Q23, actually we are calling it as Q1, that is heat added to the cycle. Is it okay with you? Okay, that I am putting small v, everything can be 1 kilogram or something, that you adjust, that is not central to our discussion here. People who want to be clinically correct can use BV, VM, whatever you. You are free to do that. That will not affect our logic. All right. For an ideal gas, what is P? correct? Are you doing fine? RT1, not V1 by V4, huh? Or that minus plus we have to adjust then, keep it, huh? Now what I am trying to do is, I want to prove that Q2 by Q1 is T1 by T2 or something. I want to prove, then I will get the Carnot, there is no problem. But to do that, it is an elaborate process. Is V3 greater than V2? Yeah. V1 is less than V4? So, some minus will come. So, we can make it into V4 by V1, whatever you want. That we will. Now, the whole idea is basically, I want to prove can you do that? P1, V1 is P2, V2, is it? That is the adiabatic process, correct? Ah, and P3, V3 to the power of come, that is correct, right? Got it? Sujit, you've done it before, right? Therefore, I am proceeding. Which is the higher temperature, T1 or T2? Huh? Is this correct? Q1 is more than, okay. Efficiency is, normally 1 is considered to be the higher temperature, okay. Normally, we'll do it as T2 minus T1 because we have taken the. So, this is the Carnot efficiency. Okay. Now it is time to define a new quantity called. You take it as homework. I think you are getting it right. How many of you got it already? Very good. Okay. I'm sorry I didn't give enough time, but it's okay, we have to move on. So now you have to define there are two statements, the Kelvin-Planck and the Clausius statement. Just take down the statements. The Kelvin-Planck statement of the second law, KP statement. It is impossible to construct a device which when operating in a cycle produces work. It is impossible to construct a device which when operating in a cycle produces work by having heat interaction. With a single reservoir at a fixed temperature. Okay. Clausius statement. It is impossible to construct a device. You just put it is impossible dash dash dash. Device which when operating in a cycle, all that is okay. It is impossible to construct a device which when operating in a cycle has HAS. As HAS followed by AS, which has as its sole effect, SOLEEFFECT, which has as its sole effect the transfer of heat, from a reservoir at low temperature to a reservoir at high temperature, That means heat by itself will flow from high temperature to low temperature. The law does not forbid you from doing this, which has as its sole effect. If you supply work, it can be done, which is happening right now. Outside is hotter, we are cooler, but we are continuously removing heat from a colder place and putting it to a hotter place. Why? We have a device called the air conditioner. If you stop the air conditioner, quickly that heat will come in 1 or 2 hours, we will reach, in a couple of hours, we will reach the temperature of the outside. Okay. Now, life is not always about cycles. Many people don't have a cycle. In thermodynamics also, we can have processes without a cycle. So, what is the story of those processes without a cycle? I am saying something serious. So, if the first law of thermodynamics is extended to a non-cyclic process, you got the property energy, because heat is equal to work. The algebraic sum of heat is equal to algebraic sum of work only for a cycle. What about those fellows who don't have a cycle? I mean, so for those processes which are non-cyclic, we have del Q equal to del U plus del W. Okay. So if you introduce a non-cyclic process, we got energy or internal energy, much in the same way as we got internal energy or energy. If we extended the first law of thermodynamics to a non-cyclic process, we got a new property which is E in its special avatar. It is the internal energy which can be written as CV into dT. So, which gives you a framework to solve many problems with just temperature. Okay, because the U, it's possible for you to make it a CV dT or dU equal. So, if the second law of thermodynamics, forget about Kelvin, Planck or Clausius who are always concentrating on cycle. if somebody doesn't have a cycle, if there is no cyclic process, if you extend it to a non-cyclic processes, a new property called entropy emerges. So the entropy is a consequence of the extension of the second law of thermodynamics to non-cyclic processes. Entropy, much like energy, is a property of the system. So it is a point function, it is not a path function. Okay? And the okay, we will do that. Okay. So DS. So the heat transfer in a reversible process, that's why I put dq reversible. What is a small dq? That means per unit mass. So the entropy per unit mass is d small s. Okay. Now please note that religiously I am putting del and del for q and w for d for this. This is a property, these two are not properties. IIT students, you should not make dq equal to du plus dw. You should not do that, right? It's a fatal mistake. Dq equal to du plus pdv. Okay. So ds. You studied all this, correct? S2 minus S1 is Cv. So if you give me the two temperatures and you either give me the pressure or volume, I can always play with P equal to RT, PV equal to RT, and I can manage. I can calculate the entropy change. It can be calculated only for a reversible process, but since it's a property, for an irreversible process also it is okay. S1 and S2. But generally it will be more than what is taken through a reversible process. Let us not get into all that. Now, the goal of introducing all this for atmospheric science course is, we are going to look at the entropy of steam, entropy of water, and what happens in a boiler, what happens in a turbine, and so on. But we want to be quickly able to link it to what happens in atmospheric science. So del Q by T is we can also write it as Cp please don't ask me how is d u equal to h minus pv dh minus pdv plus vdp vdp pdv will get cancelled vdp all that you know that okay let us quickly go through this but we know that Cp we derived it, right? This one we derived in an earlier class when we got the potential term. Look at this. So this is now derived. This we know. RHS is the same. Therefore, the fun is not that. The fun is let me check whether you are following the lecture. The fun is Cp d theta by theta equal to dq by t, which is also equal to therefore whatever, right? Is that correct? Or I will simply make it like this. So, in an adiabatic process which usually takes place in the atmosphere, if the potential temperature is conserved, it goes without saying that the entropy remains constant. Therefore, the potential temperature which is remaining constant in a reversible adiabatic process with which you are taking the air parcel all the way up and all that. So, when the air parcel undergoes this and this process and goes up all the way up to its LCL following a dry adiabat, it is also following an isentropic. So, the potential temperature is used as a surrogate for an isentropic process. Surrogate is a proxy or a replacement for. So, the isentropic process and the constant potential temperature, the dry adiabat are one and the same in atmospheric science. So, that brings us the link to second law of thermodynamics, why we should study second law of thermodynamics in relation to atmospheric science, okay. So, the moral of the story is a not very good example is CGPA is a surrogate for learning. You may not agree with me, that is a belief, right? That is a common belief. CGPA or percentage is a surrogate for how much learning you have taken. It is questionable. I am not opening up a Pandora's box like that. The instead of entropy, please use theta, okay? Because there is something called, anyway, I will get into philosophy. So, I was just reading a new book, The Art of Thinking Clearly, okay, where he proposes various syndromes and this thing, and he calls it as in science the fallacy of a single cause. There is something called the fallacy of a single cause, which is called the causal oversimplification. If an effect is produced by several causes, quickly we will try to identify one cause. What is the cause for the Uttarakhand rain? There may be many causes, and we quickly put the blame. Okay, so actually, if you go deeper, there are two sets of causes. There can be a proximal cause, there can be a distal cause, and the proximal causes seem to, hey, please choose me, please choose me. I mean, you want to fall into the trap and choose that. There are a lot of distal variables. So, this is called, I mean, you reduce everything, for everything there is only one effect. Then if you start talking like this, then only you are an expert, no, for everything you have a theory, I mean, there is only one cause. But there are cross correlation between the causes. Okay, even the learning CGPA, there are multiple reasons, multiple causes are there. Okay, so this, why did I say all this? Okay, so there is some surrogate. Okay, so we have to be very careful. Anyway, in this case, it is very innocuous and harmless. So, instead of the entropy, we will use the theta. All right, so the Carnot cycle must be represented on a TS diagram. So, we represent it on a TS diagram. So, correct? Q equal to TDS. when the temperature is integral TdS, T can be taken out because it is isothermal process. Yes. You must have studied this, right? Okay. The Carnot cycle becomes a rectangle. The net area under a TS diagram is the heat added. But since it's a cyclic process, it is the same as the work done. The net area under a PV diagram is work done. Again, in a cyclic process, since heat added, since it is a cycle, del U is equal to 0, the net work done is equal to the net heat added. Okay? Now, the last part of the lecture is basically the Clausius-Clapeyron equation, which we will derive now. Physics people call it as the first latent heat equation. Thermodynamicists call it as the Clausius-Clapeyron equation in honor of the two scientists. Again, consider consider a Carnot cycle working between two small pressure differences, right? Between two small pressure differences, two pressures which have a small difference. Okay. No, it will be like this. A why that this fellow became like this is there is a phase change which is taking place. Okay, this is Q1. So here the pressure is PV sat. Here the pressure is PV sat minus dPV sat. So it is a Carnot cycle operating between infinitesimal pressure difference, and at this PV saturation, what happens is at 100 degree centigrade, for example, 1 atmosphere water will change phase, correct? So if this is T, this is T minus dT. The pressure and temperature are one and the same within the saturation, you know that, right? Okay. Now, a Carnot cycle is operating between these two pressures, okay? So we know that Q1 by T1 equal to Q2 by T2, that we already seen, right? Q2 by Q1 is... No, what did I write now? T2 by T2. Now we again change it to T1 and T2. Okay, for the sake of continuity. Or we'll mess it up. Huh? What do you want to do? Tell me. Q1 by T2 equal to. Huh? It's okay. Want like this? So this is in line with what you have discussed. It's awkward, but it's okay. So anyway, if you say it is fine. Now this is also equal to, agreed. If half is equal to 3 by 4, then 3 minus 1 by 4 minus 2 is also equal to half. That is called the dividendo componendo rule. Or the componendo dividendo rule. With some, that does it ring a bell? Okay. All right. So, Q1 by T2, that is, I don't like it, man. Q1 by, but anyway, should be Q1 by T1. And, okay. It doesn't matter. There is no logical error, right? It's fine. So, Q1 by T2 is equal to Q1 minus Q2 by this thing. So, what is Q1 minus Q2? Area of the parallelogram. Work done, but evaluate it. Line segment BC into DPV sat, correct? All right. What is Q1? Please tell me now. A saturated moist process, water is changing into water vapor, or water vapor is changing into water, Q will be equal to? Latent heat into 1 kg LV. Okay. Therefore, LV by T equal to BC. Can I call T2 minus T1 as DT? Of course, yes. Yes. Minus plus, if there is a problem, you have to take care. All right. I am out of it. What is BC? From the figure. V2 minus V1. Change in volume, okay. Okay. BC del V. Okay. Okay. So, let me call this V2 and let me call this V1. V2 is the volume of the vapor and V1 is the volume of the liquid. So, this del V, the specific volume V2 is much, much greater than V1, right? Liquid is changing to vapor. Specific volume is much larger, correct? Therefore, but now, when it has become vapor, it follows the ideal gas, correct? So, correct? Now, the water has become vapor. Please correct me if I am making any mistake. Am I right? The R for the water vapor is universal gas constant divided by the molecular weight of water vapor. So, what I have indicated within that box is basically the Clausius-Clapeyron equation. In the atmosphere, this fellow can be simplified as in simple English, if you give me the temperature and if you give me the latent heat at that temperature, I can tell you how from a particular PV, how the del PV will change from one saturated vapor pressure, how the saturated vapor pressure will change with temperature. Okay. If water boils at 100 degrees centigrade, for 1 bar, at 1.2 bar, what will be the temperature you can get from the Clausius-Clapeyron equation? Or for 110 degrees centigrade, what should be the pressure? Either way. Okay. So, the Clausius-Clapeyron equation is very, because latent heat processes are all the time involved in the atmosphere, this is widely used in atmospheric science calculations. But in our course, it is the first course. So, I may ask you a simple question. Give you one vapor pressure and this thing and give one temperature and ask you to calculate what will be the vapor pressure for a different temperature or something, or for the given temperature, if the temperature is slightly changed, what will be the vice versa. Is it okay? So, we will stop now. Finally, this brings us to the end of atmospheric thermodynamics. We are done with atmospheric thermodynamics. We will get on to RT, that is radiative transfer.